Yes, you have heard that right. Kafka explained in just 15 minutes everything that you need to know about Kafka. Kafka powers billions of messages every day at Uber, Netflix, Airbnb. But what is it really? How does it handle so much of data? And why it's replacing all the traditional data pipelines everywhere? Kafka is more than a tool. It streams data, stores it reliably, and processes billions of events at speed. You don't need to be an expert. I'll break down Kafka, producers, consumer, partition, topics, everything that you need to know, using real example of Airbnb and simple visuals. Hey guys, welcome back. Imagine we are building an app like Airbnb, a marketplace for traveler and host. To start with, our platform is powered by microservices handling booking, payments, messages, availability, notification, and more. Now picture this. A guest book a stay in Barcelona. That single action, one click, sets off a chain of reaction of events across multiple services. The booking service confirms the reservation. The availability service blocks the date for the host. The payment service charges the guest card and handles the host payout. A message is sent to the host. You have got a new booking. A confirmation email is triggered for the guest. Analytics service logs the event to update revenue, occupancy trends, and market insights. All of this from one single action. Now, we are still small startup, so we build it the simplest way we know, microservices. Just directly call each other. The booking service pings all the others. Hey, we just got a new booking. Go and do your part. It's fast, it works, and it feels fine at first. But then we go viral on social media. Everyone is talking about us. Suddenly, we are handling hundreds of thousands of bookings a day. New Year deal drops, host slash prices, and user flood the app. And that's when it happens. The platform starts crashing. Pages freeze. User sees infinite loading wheels. Booking fails. Payout gets delayed. Hosts get angry. Why? Because our nice clean architecture on the whiteboard turned into a tangled web of tightly coupled services. Every spike in traffic causes cascading failure. A single slow service can bring down the whole chain. Let's say the payment service goes down. Maybe the third party card processor is unresponsive, or the service crashes under heavy load. When that happens, the entire booking flow freezes. The booking service is stuck waiting, nothing moves, one weak link and whole chain breaks. We have built everything around synchronous communication. Every microservice is calling the next one, like, hey, I did my part, now it's your turn. Let me know when you are done. It's like tipping the first in line of falling book on the shelf. One movement leads to dozen more. And during peak traffic, guests are stuck on spinning wheels. Hosts don't get notified. Revenue data is missing. Refunds and payouts get delayed. One 10-minute downtime of the availability service, it leads up to 2 hours of booking blockage. Thousands of customer lost, hours of analytics data gone. The architecture that once felt sleek, now it feels like chaos. After another week of firefighting, the team huddles. What if we completely rethink how these services talk to each other? We would break the tight coupling. We would stop making services wait on each other. And in the middle, we will introduce a message broker, a tool that each services could hand their data to, without worrying about who picks it up when. Think of it like an airport control tower. When a plane takes off from Barcelona to Berlin, it doesn't need to coordinate directly with the Berlin airport customs, baggage handlers, and ground crew. Instead, it sends its flight's plan to air traffic control. And from there, everything is routed and handed in the right order. That's Kafka. It sits in the middle of your system, a powerful distributed event streaming platform that receives data from one service, store it reliably, and allow other services to pick it up when they are ready. So now, when a booking happens, the booking service doesn't need to wait for payment, message, analytics, or availability updates. Imagine it like this. A guest just booked a listing in Paris on Airbnb. The booking service sends an event to Kafka, something like, "Hey, a booking was made for a guest 123 for listing 789 from July 3rd to July 7th. Here are the details." And that's it. It doesn't wait around to see if everyone else receives it. It drops the message off and moves on to handle the next booking. That's message, called an event, has a simple structure, a key, example guest ID or booking ID, a value, the payload of actual data, and some metadata like timestamp, versioning, etc. The booking service that creates and sends the events to Kafka is known as producer. It produces events. But now comes to the next question. Where do all these events go? We have services producing events for payments, host payout, guest messages, availability changes, and more. Do all booking events, cancellations, messages, and reviews end up in one massive chaotic stream? No, that would be a mess, a total chaos. Instead, Kafka uses a concept called topics. You can think of topics like a labeled channels or dedicated mail slots. One for bookings, one for payments, one for availability updates. So the booking service writes its messages to the booking topic. The payment service writes to the payments topic. The availability service might write to the calendar updates and so on. This keeps everything clean, organized, and scalable because each topic can be independently scaled and managed. So, back to our booking topic. A new booking event was added by the booking service. Now what? That single event might trigger a dozen of downstream actions, like notify the host and guest, update the calendar to block those dates, log the transaction for analytics, generate an invoice, trigger payments and payouts flow. But who does all this? That's where consumers come in. These are the microservices that subscribe to specific Kafka topics. They listen for new events, and when one appears, they react. In our case, the notification service is subscribed to the booking topic. When it sees a new booking, it sends email or in-app messages to both the guest and host. The calendar service listens to the same topic, sees the booking events, and updates the host availability. The analytics service also listens and logs the booking for reporting and dashboarding. The payment service might trigger invoice generation or payments retries if needed. Each of these services is acting independently in real time without slowing each other down. And they trust Kafka to deliver those events reliably and in order. Now let's talk real time analytics. One of Kafka's most powerful use cases is when you need to react to a constant stream of data as it happens. In Airbnb's world, think about a live sales dashboard showing bookings per minute, per region or category. A fraud detection stream system spotting bookings anomalies in real time. Maybe a guest location stream. If you are testing features like proximity-based experience, suggestions or smart key handovers. In this case, Kafka offers more than just event delivery. it gives you Kafka Stream, a powerful stream processing API built right into the Kafka ecosystem. So what is the difference? Traditional consumers read one event at a time and perform some quick action, like sending a confirmation email or inserting a row into database. But stream processing do more. They continuously ingest data, aggregate, filter, join multiple topics, and detect pattern over time, not just react to isolated records. For example, a smart pricing service could monitor the booking and availability updates topic and constantly recalculate nightly prices based on the real-time demand, cancellation, and competitor rates. But here is the cool part. You don't have to use Kafka Stream always. You can use Spark Structured Streaming instead. Spark lets you connect directly to Kafka topics, define your stream logic using data frames and SQL-like queries, and they execute that logic at scale across a Spark cluster. So whenever you are building a lightweight service with Kafka Stream or a high throughput distributed pipeline with Spark Streaming, Kafka sits at the center, feeding real-time data into your analytics system. That's what makes Kafka so powerful in modern data engineering. It's not just a message bus, it's a foundation for real-time intelligence. But hold up, what happens when this system scales? How does Kafka handle so much of data? Airbnb is not processing 10 bookings a day. It's dealing with millions of events, from booking messages, payments, availability updates, non-stop. Kafka would melt under process if it handles all of this as a single pipeline. That's why Kafka introduces partitions. Partitions are the core unit of scalability in Kafka. Think of it like customer support center. Say a customer support team receives thousands of tickets a day, some from Europe, some from North America, and some from Asia. You wouldn't route all tickets through a single support agent. You would split the workload. That's exactly what Kafka does. Let's say we have a topic called bookings. You can split that into multiple partitions. Now Kafka can write in parallel across partitions. This allows Kafka to handle massive throughput without bottlenecks. But wait, if producer can scale horizontally with partitions, what about the consumer? Imagine all those booking events being written to a Kafka at lightning fast speed. Every click, confirmation and cancellation from user around the world, streaming in real time. Now picture only one system, say an analytics service, trying to consume them all from every region. That's like asking a single person to read every airline booking confirmation across the globe. It's a total overload, right? That's where consumer groups comes in. Let's say the analytics team want to process this fire hose of booking events. They spin up multiple instances of their analytics microservices. Each instance handles a different subset of Kafka partition. Kafka automatically assigns partition to these consumers. One might handle bookings EU, another bookings US, and so on. Together, they form a consumer group. Each message goes to only one consumer in the group, and no message is missed. This is how Kafka achieves horizontal scalability on the consumer side. But what if you want to do more complex processing? Aggregations, filtering, join across topics? That's where Apache Sparks come in. You can connect Apache Spark Structured Streaming as Kafka consumer. Spark itself acts as a consumer group, and Spark handles parallel processing across the cluster, just like our microservices earlier. but with the power of distributed computing and built-in fault tolerance. So whether it's a fleet of microservices or a Spark streaming job, Kafka ensures that the data is spread efficiently, processed once, and scales beautifully. That's the magic of consumer group. It's how Kafka handles millions of events per second without breaking a sweat. And it's a big reason why Kafka and Spark are a match made in real-life data heaven. So far, we have talked a lot about events and topics. But where are these events actually stored? That's the job of Kafka Broker. A Kafka Broker is a server that stores messages, handle requests from producer and consumer, and replicates data for fault tolerance. Every booking confirmation, availability updates, payments, or message between host and guest gets saved to a disk in one of the branches. Even if one branch goes down, Kafka's replication ensures that data exists on another. Just like keeping multiple copies of guest record in different region data centers. This is one of the big reasons Kafka stand apart from traditional message brokers. So, what started as a simple booking, a stay in Barcelona, triggered a ripple across a complex distributed system. But instead of letting our services fall into chaos, instead of letting one slow call bring everything down, we introduced Kafka to bring order, reliability. We moved from synchronous bottlenecks to asynchronous flows, from fragile chains to resilient stream, from services talking directly to services reacting to events. Kafka did not just help us scale, it helped us think differently about how data should move. Because in the world of modern data engineering, it's not just about storing and querying data that flows in real time, at scale, with confidence. And this is just the beginning. In the next episode, we will go deeper into Kafka's internals, how data is partitioned, how consumers scale, how Kafka ensures fault tolerance in a distributed world. Until then, if this helps you reimagine how data should move, hit like, subscribe, and drop a comment. Let's build smarter pipelines together.